Rise up, single mom.
Bite your tongue, particularly if you are not complete in your relationship with the father. Yeah. And you have so many negative thoughts and opinions, negative experiences. Talk about your negative experiences with the father, with your girlfriends, not with your children.
It all can get so out of control. Sometimes you can lose your faith, you can lose your mind, lose your grip, get stripped of your pride, till you don't know how you're gonna stay alive.
Hi, moms. Welcome to the Rise Up Single Mom podcast, empowered by the Kazookian Network. Today, I'll be talking with Miss Joy Doss. She has a 12-year-old daughter, and today's topic is all about the journey to co-parenting. We're also going to talk about how it has been with the long distance between New York and Memphis, and then transitioning into becoming a co-parent and what that really looks like. Affirmations have been amazing the last 10 years of my life, and I want to share with you and also challenge you to share, to speak out loud this affirmation with me. My child's father and I will successfully co-parent, and our child or children will greatly benefit. Okay? Say it again. Say it with confidence. My child's father and I will successfully co-parent, and our child or children will greatly benefit. We'll be right back with Miss Joy Doss.
Three.
He was cheating, and back then they had a little bit more decorum and discretion.
B.
These days they don't even.
Well, they played their position.
C.
And if you get you some goodies outside, whatever. The agreement is, I don't know about it. You keep it private, and it never comes to this house.
3BC. Three Black Chicks on the Kazookian Network.
Welcome to Rise Up Single Mom Podcast with Clarissa Joy. I am so excited for this new show. And today I'll be talking with Miss Joy Doss. This show is near and dear to my heart because at one point in time, I thought that life was on an okay trajectory. I had, you know, checked the boxes, right? And I was living what I thought was an okay American dream until bam. I went from being married to finding myself becoming a single mom to a 15-month-old. So this show is going to be here to support other single moms, to uplift you, to encourage you, and also to challenge you along the way. So my guest today, Joy Doss, we are here. And Joy, I know there are several ways to become a single mom. The statistics say that 50% become single moms after divorce, 30% become single moms, they were never married, and then 20% are separated or widowed. So what was your path into becoming a single mom?
I am the never married.
Okay.
I'm in a never married box.
Okay.
I guess, let me clarify, I'm going to say never married / shacked up for multiple years, almost common law married, haven't been in the South box. So that's how long we were together.
Okay.
That's a single mom thing, though. Like, I feel like you got to quantify your time together.
It is.
So people don't feel like, oh, you just out here willy-nilly making babies.
Absolutely. That is what we do. And it's almost second nature to do it.
Because
we feel this thing inside where we've got to explain our story, mm-hmm. even if nobody asked. Mm-hmm. And why do we do that, Joy? Why do you think?
Well, I know for me, you know, a lot of it was I never wanted to be stereotyped.
Mm-hmm.
We had a conversation before we were recording, and I was like, you know, my first go-to was like, but I'm educated.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, it's not, and that doesn't matter.
I'm not one of those single moms.
Yeah, and I knew it when I said it. That doesn't
matter. The
quantifier. It doesn't really make sense. But I was just, you know, stomping, mm-hmm. being indignant. And
just let me know. Who
yes.
you really are.
Yes.
Right. Outside of being a single mom. That's
yes.
so common. That
it is
so common, Joy. So I was also sharing before the recording that when I transitioned to become a single mom, I had so much shame and embarrassment, slick paranoia. What would others think if they knew now I went from this picture perfect air quotes life to now I'm a single mom? And I admitted that I'd even worn my wedding ring over a year after the divorce. Mm-hmm. So Tell me about that. How have you ever felt those feelings of being like embarrassed or shameful? Do you feel there's a stigma with the term single mom?
There's absolutely stigma in being a single mom. I still have on my Big Mama's ring. My mom gave it to me while I was pregnant. My daughter's father and I split up while I was pregnant.
Wow.
So that's a whole nother probably episode. Whole nother story. But the reason why I was wearing the ring, I had bought a junky one from like Macy's, just a little junky faux diamond. So I was wearing that around because I was doing PR in New York, and you know, all the white girls live in Connecticut with their husband,
Becky,
and they live in Greenwich and everything, and the husband has a hedge fund. And here I am still trying, I need to work still, you know? And I was in panic mode because I didn't know what was going to happen with him. You know, we weren't exactly getting along. So I was like, shit, I got to work. I said that, but I was like, I got to work, you know? And I'm like still like doing my thing. So I have this ring on. And my mom sees it. She's like, you know, she's not a fake diamond type of person. She's like, what is that? Why are you wearing this?
Where'd that come from?
So she pulls out my grandmother's ring. This is my grandmother's wedding ring. I still wear it, but now I wear it for a different reason. And truly it did not keep the men off me. I had more play when I was pregnant.
Head turns.
Than I was at this age, 47.
Wow. Okay. So tell me, what was your reason for wearing it previously, right? When you were pregnant versus your reason now for wearing it?
I didn't want to be stereotyped. I just, you know, I didn't want the white girls to look at me like another little ghetto black chick, you know, in here trying to slip into their sorority or whatever, you know. But now I wear because it makes me feel close to my big mama, you know, and I always feel close. And I always make sure I have it on. Sometimes I wake up in the night and make sure it's still just there. And I just grab my, I touch it to make sure it's there because, you know, I feel close to my big mama.
Okay. So totally different reason now, but I get it. Back when you were pregnant with your daughter, it was like, no, I have got to be accepted. I want to be in the club. I want to be liked and not discriminated against or stereotyped as a single mom.
Because they're judging you, especially in PR. And super especially in PR in New York. They're judging you off the rip, you know, just from the gate. They're judging you. You know, do you have the right bag, the shoes, what's your jewelry like or whatever, you know. So they're making judgments already. Never mind, you're already walking around in this skin that I'm in.
Right. So, that black skin.
Yeah.
Then there's that.
Yeah.
Right.
It's always that.
So you mentioned New York. So let me ask you this. Do you feel there are difference in the stereotypes or how we feel as single moms from North versus South? I guess that's East Coast. East Coast versus how you felt in the South.
Yes, I think there's more. I don't think there's more acceptance. I think it's just a different approach to it. I mean, there's single moms everywhere, right?
Sure.
New York, it wasn't a big deal. Here, I just feel more of a sense of community. At the time, you know, my girlfriends that had kids, one of them, I was in Brooklyn. My one girlfriend's in the Bronx. My other girlfriend, my closest girls, my other girlfriend had moved to Texas. Okay. So the rest of my friends, they're still hanging out. I was like, I would never leave my baby with none of y'all. I love y'all.
What do you mean hanging out? Like
going hard. They still hanging. Partying.
Okay.
I was like, nah.
Tough.
I love y'all.
But
you ain't finna watch my baby, not never. I love y'all. Don't get me wrong, but you gotta know your people. So I felt very isolated, you know, because I felt like there wasn't a lot I could do, you know, and her dad wasn't giving me any peace at the time. You know, I just didn't feel like I had the backup that I needed. But here, there's more of a sense of a community. And maybe it's because I'm from Memphis, you know, and I have
back home.
Yeah, I'm home. And I have my mom and I have my oldest friends and all of that stuff. And it's just a different sense of that, you know. But people also, at the time, not anymore because I'm in my 40s, but they expect you to have another baby. Not get married.
When's the next one coming?
Not even get married. Not even I have a nice young man for you to meet.
Isn't that a twisted
thought,
though?
When you having a baby? I was like, I got to get this one.
Just because you have one baby and you're not married, then they just assume. Is there an assumption there that you're just going to keep having babies?
Just keep going. Just a baby mama factory. Like, just a collecting baby daddies. I was like, first of all, let me get this one off the boot. Like, I mean, this one's still on the boot. Like, settle down, everybody.
Okay. So speaking of your child's father, we're going to take a pause. But when we come back, we're going to talk about co-parenting. That's what this episode is all about. And we're going to dig into the nitty gritty about how it is to truly co-parent.
I got up and went to the gym at 9 o'clock this morning. We talked about on the show the kind of workouts I do. It's not fun. I work out until I feel like I'm either going to pass out or throw up. And when I get to that point, I'm just like, oh, I haven't done either. Guess I got to keep going.
The hell with all of that.
And then like
I
after
got
that,
like tasks and stuff like, to do afterwards.
Exactly. Exactly. I was tired, boss.
Black Nerd Power on the Kazookian Network. Kazookian.
Welcome back to the Rise Up Single Mom podcast. We are back with my guest today, Joy Doss, mother of one amazing little girl. And Joy, I want to share this with you. There are a number of celebrities that are co-parenting. That's what today's show is about. I just wanted to share a couple quotes. One, Ben Affleck and his ex, Jennifer Garner, they have three, and they made the comment that you have to be on the same page. You have to cooperate. What do you think about that statement when it comes to co-parenting?
You absolutely do, and it's not always easy, particularly when the separation wasn't as sweet.
Okay. Not as you would have liked for it to have gone.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not getting along, like we weren't getting along.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there's a lot of trust issues there, you know. So it's really hard to get on the same page.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's always been the problem. He's coming from here. I'm coming from here.
Right.
We're trying to get to the same place.
How do you meet in the middle, right?
Yeah, and we're trying to get to the same place. We have the same goal in mind, the same destination.
Which is the baby. From,
we have two different approaches.
Okay.
So it's really hard to meet in the middle for us. And we have to work at it very intentionally.
Mm-hmm.
And we always know that, you know, Addison, my daughter, is first. She's, you know, her what's best for her is always first.
Okay, absolutely. I want to share this next quote. So Shaquille O'Neal and his ex-wife, Shawnee O'Neal, they co-parent four children. And a comment that they made was, it took us a long time to get here. It was not an easy journey. But once we got there, we felt comfortable being honest with each other. So I want to ask you, how do you think, or can you share with us what your journey was like to this place now of positive co-parenting versus, you know, in the past?
A lot of cussing and therapy. Like, we come to Jesus. Like,
okay.
I mean, we cuss each other out.
So explain come to Jesus. What do you mean by that?
Like, love adjacent cussing out. And that's part of the come to Jesus. You know, we have these talks about, okay, well, you know, getting through our stuff, you know, kind of wading through the murky waters of our past and sorting through that. So having those real, and that's that honesty, having those really honest, transparent conversations, you know, you hurt me.
Right.
How am I supposed to trust you when you, I was like, listen, he's always like, you trust me. I was like, I mean,
but wait,
you really shattered. I was like, listen, one time I told him, I said, listen, I don't know if you understand, but you crushed me.
Mm-hmm.
Like my soul into a million granular pieces.
Right.
And he got that. I was like, you crushed me. And it took me years to get back from that.
How did you get to this point of being so transparent with him to even tell him that line? How did you get
there? We've always been transparent, but therapy.
Okay. Therapy.
Therapy wasn't just about him. I mean, therapy was just for my own general well-being, but it also helped me find the language that I needed to communicate to him most effectively, where he can receive it, he can really hear it, versus just listening, where he can really hear it and absorb it, you know, and make it actionable, you know, make his next moves actionable, you know, moves that kind of help write the ship.
Right. So it's almost like an art to it, would you say? Because you just mentioned,
it's certainly a dance.
Communicating, how he could hear you, how you guys go forward, you know, having that common goal, the child in the midst of all of this and the feelings and emotions and trauma that you mentioned of being shattered previously. So let me ask you this. When it comes to a young woman that's listening to this show now, what would you tell her is the first step to get there? Because in my experience, there were a million raging emotions, and I felt like I was on a roller coaster day to day, week to week, right? Mm-hmm. One moment you feel like everything is okay, the next moment is like, ugh. Mm-hmm. So what would you say, to the single moms that are listening in on how do you make that first step, right?
Intention. I mean, it's just intention. Mm-hmm. You have to make a decision to be okay.
Mm, I like that. A decision.
You make a decision to
be okay. So it doesn't haphazardly happen. Poof. Everything's okay.
No.
We getting along. Everything's cool.
No.
Okay.
No, you make a decision to be okay. First of all, with yourself. Like, mm-hmm. I'm okay. And I have to be okay because I have to be a mom. Mm-hmm. You know, I have to be my best me so I can be the best mom.
I love that. So, I absolutely love that, because sometimes as a single mom, we lose sight of ourselves, who we are at our core, because we're so, concerned about the child. And then, of course, on the other side, we're thinking about all those things that his or her father may have done to us or what happened in the past in our relationship. So I love that you just mentioned it's an intentional decision to say, hey, mm-hmm. we're going to do this. We're going to co-parent. This is what's best for our child, which is the common goal.
And you also remember that, hey, as long as you're doing right by mm-hmm. my child, we don't have a problem.
Bam. That's all that matters.
I don't care how you feel about me.
That's all that matters.
I don't care if we cuss on each other every day. But as long as you do right by her,
right,
then I'm fine. Okay. We're good. Just do right by her. But he knows, if I even think something stinks, he's getting called on it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because I'm fiercely protected. I am Mama Bear.
But that's just a mother's intuition, right?
Oh, it's more than that. It's Mama Bear. I will rip you limb from limb about my child.
You
limb
will go to
limb.
Jail.
I will. I will absolutely go to jail over my child. And I don't care who it is.
Yeah. Been there. Done that.
Mm-hmm.
Got the record.
I see. They'll tell you.
Okay. And I'm happy that you mentioned therapy, because sometimes that's looked at upon as a negative thing, especially in the Black community. So, what made it okay for you to be like, okay, we need therapy. I need therapy.
It's a healthy thing. It's not negative. There shouldn't be any shame attached to it. We really have to let that go. We have to be healthy.
Yes.
We have to commit to being healthy. We have to commit to being okay, because everybody's looking at us.
Absolutely.
To do and to carry and to think of something, mm-hmm. to think of everything and rescue, whatever the case may be at the time. We have to be okay. Our shoulders have to be strong.
Right.
But internally, we have to be okay. And what drove me to therapy wasn't even about him or parenting or any of that. It was something else. I was just feeling, overwhelmed. I felt like I wasn't working a lot at the time. So I felt like, oh my God, I've aged out of the workplace.
Uh-oh.
In my early 40s. I was freaking out.
Girl, 40 is the new 30. What are you talking about?
At the time, I was like freaking out because I had gone a long stretch without a lot of work.
Okay.
So I was freaking out, and I was really not okay.
Okay.
And that's what took me to therapy initially.
Gotcha. I'm so glad you mentioned that, because the other celebrity couple I wanted to mention, Robin Thicke and his ex Paula Patton, that was what they said is what helped them get to a healthy place of communication, was co-parenting therapy specifically.
We haven't done that one.
Okay.
You haven't individual done that therapy.
Yeah. Well, Robin Thicke and Paula Patton said that they swear by co-parenting therapy in helping them get to that healthy place of communication. So hang on, folks. We'll be right back. Mom, stick with us. Okay.
I'll be right there.
I'll play the blues for you.
Well, that was his on stage look.
Right.
He had the dancing ladies with him always. Mm-hmm. And they were all about 40-something mm-hmm. back then.
Special one. Oh, yeah.
Drop that zero.
That's the name of this song. I got to sleep with one eye open. Shirley Brown.
Got to watch you.
The thrill is gone.
Blues in the Basement. Part of the Kazookian Network.
The thrill is gone away.
Kazookian.
Welcome back to the Rise Up Single Mom Podcast, empowered by the Kazookian Network. I am talking today with Miss Joy Doss, and thank you so much for your authenticity during this interview. You've just been such a blast today.
Well, thank you.
We, can
it.
We be friends in real life?
We can. We sure can.
Okay. So you mentioned in the last segment about your daughter's father being in New York. Mm-hmm. You're home now in Memphis, mm-hmm. Tennessee. So I want to ask you, what is it like? Because with my daughter's father and myself, we've always been in the same city or close proximity within, 20, 30 mile radius. Uh-huh. So what is that like for the single moms out there that may be listening that are not in the same geographical area as their children's father?
So I got to tell you, there's a couple of factors here. Mm-hmm. One, this has always been her normal. When we moved to Memphis, she was 5-6 months old.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So my daughter was born in September 2008. Lehman Brothers happened in October 2008. So the bottom just fell out.
Is that where you were working?
No, but it didn't matter because it was a ripple effect all throughout the city. No one was where it was.
In New York.
New York was hit so hard. And certainly, okay. So for what I do, PR is just a luxury line item for a lot of companies, particularly and especially events.
Sure.
They were a luxury line item. So my stuff was falling apart.
So it's like they don't actually need that and they can just do away with it if they're trying to save money.
Or else they'll do paid media, which is advertising.
Okay.
Which is a direct, return. Mm-hmm. You kind of get. It's a little more of a straight line. So it was just really not popping for me. Mm-hmm. I was like, all right, I got to call it, because I'm not going to be out here. I thought about everything. I was like, I could do temping, mm-hmm. but then I'd be temping to pay. Because, again, he and I are in an uncertain place. So I didn't know how much he was helping. Later, mm-hmm. he's like, I didn't want y'all to move. I was like, well, you ain't say that.
And at that time,
you think
about the baby. We got to eat.
And I probably wouldn't have believed him.
Okay.
I would have been like, whatever.
Right.
Because the trust thing, right? Mm-hmm. Like, it's hard to rebuild the trust. So,
absolutely.
I had to call it. I just wasn't working. When I left, she was so small. So that's all she really knew. That was her normal.
Wow.
We established it as her normal. But as she became older, it made more of a difference because she needed more of him. He was coming down pretty regularly. I mean, probably three, four times a year.
So okay.
He'd come down pretty regularly, stay for a week, 10 days.
Oh, wow.
Whatever. And he still does come down regularly, even though
great.
He's remarried.
Mm-hmm.
I always say, that's the other thing, remarried. We weren't married.
What's
I say remarried. I don't even
but
know.
But he wasn't, y'all weren't married.
No.
So why are you saying remarried?
I don't know.
Because you probably felt with the cohabitation, right? It felt like you were married, even if you weren't legally, like with the papers.
He sure in the hell got on my nerves like we was married, y'all.
Mm.
I'll say that.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so he was coming here regularly 3-4 times a year.
Yeah, and then I would go there because I was still working. So when I would come, at least once a year, I would come and bring her with me.
Okay.
Spring break time, like March, we would still go every spring break until last year. It was the first spring break we didn't go.
Okay.
And even when she was a baby, and if I had to do some work or something, I'd take her and my mom would come with or whatever.
Oh, so sweet.
Yeah. So it was really cool. And but as she got older, she needed more of him and, things
hit
different, right? Like she's processing things differently as an older kid,
uh-huh.
9, 10, 11.
Right.
Even 12 this age.
Like,
so
I think that's the age they grow horns. Like, where did you come from? And where is my child?
It was about 10 for me.
Yeah, same here. 10.
I was like, wow.
Bring me my baby back.
Right? That baby's gone, man. Like, I was just like, wow. I don't even know.
So 5-6 months old, you guys moved back home to Memphis from New York. So this really has been her norm of not being in the same city, home, if you will, life with her father.
Yeah.
So what would you say now is, as she's gotten older, how does she process it now?
Now she
being
wants
12.
To move to New York for high school.
What?
And I am not okay.
What?
I'm not okay.
And you have a girl, right? A daughter.
Yes.
And she wants to move with her dad for high school?
I'm going to have to let her do it because I can't be the villain.
What? Mm-hmm. Oh, I think that was a dagger to my heart.
Breaking news. So I'm going to let her do it. I mean, if she may change her mind, but I certainly don't want her to. Her dad has definitely been working on her.
I was gonna ask that was gonna be my next question. So how does he feel about it? What are his thoughts?
He's been working on it for years.
Okay. Yeah. So he's good with it. He's encouraging it.
That's one way to put it. Yes.
What's the other way to put it?
Well, that's another show.
Okay.
But
okay.
Yes, that's one way to put it. He's encouraging her.
Okay. So the emotional side of co-parenting, I want to ask you about that because it's a real thing, especially in your situation where you guys are not in the same city or state. How has the emotional side been for you?
Well, she went up there, I think, not last year, 2020, such a watch. Okay. Not
right.
20.
COVID.
19. No. She was up there 2019, and then she went 2018 by herself. She flew by herself.
Was that the first time?
Yes. Oh, my God. I was sobbing. I couldn't wait for her to go down there. And then she
Mama
had
Bear
on the jetway.
Sure.
She was like, I don't want to go. I was like, you're going to be fine.
Uh-huh.
You're
breathe. Fine. Breathe, baby. Breathe.
And it was storming.
Wow.
Lightning, all of that. I was like, oh, my God. I'm sobbing. I was sobbing. I could barely breathe. So, you know, emotionally, that week, like, mm-hmm. she was gone like a week and a half, and I was like, I don't have anything to do. You realize how much of your life is their life?
It's their life, totally.
Last summer, she was there. My daughter's a ballerina, and she was there for summer intensive. Or 2019, she was there for summer intensive at Joffrey Ballet. And I was like, man, it was like a month.
Were you living your best life? How'd that look?
No, it just looked like
was it the opposite?
I wasn't prepared at all. I was like, you just realize how much of your time they take up. I just wasn't
absolutely
ready. So yeah, emotionally it is difficult to, you know, you wean them as a baby and then you wean again as a teenager, give them, you know, freedom and, you know, longer handle spoon and everything. So it's just, it does take a toll emotionally. I mean, so many different, and you know, I don't really have her, me and her dad are cordial or whatever.
Sure.
But that's he's great. Not an emotional support. Okay. He's not my, I wouldn't be talking to confiding him in him about anything.
Right. So how do you do that? What's your outlet?
Therapy.
Back to therapy.
But then you have your mommy coven, right? Like you have this, you know.
Yeah.
The mom, or just your friends in general, though. I mean, they may not be able to relate, but they do know me.
Right.
So then you have, have other moms that really, you know, they understand.
Sure. That's great. I'm so happy that you mentioned that because, you know, being a single mom, one of the things when I was a single mom that I always thought is I was the only person in that situation. I was the only person that had those thoughts, emotions, et cetera. So what you've just shared with us, thank you for your transparency, is that it's okay to feel that way and you can work through it. Therapy is an amazing resource.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know,
you feel all the things.
Yeah.
All the things.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you so much, Joy Doss, for sharing with us today. Amazing story you have with your daughter and co-parenting. And let me just congratulate you as we close out the show on you and your child's father, your daughter's father, on being able to co-parent. That's an amazing thing.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. It's not an easy thing, but thank you.
Right. As you mentioned, intentional, but we can make it happen.
We can.
Well, moms, you have been listening to the Rise Up Single Mom podcast, empowered by the Kazukian Network. Be sure to follow us on Instagram as well as Facebook at Rise Up Single Mom. And you can subscribe to this Kazukian app or by going to www.kazukian.com. Rise Up Single Mom.
Directed, produced, and distributed by Kazukian.